Chairman, good afternoon. My name is Kevin Clashon. I am the president of the Dürrenbach Research Institute. I want to welcome you to this very, very special occasion, which marks the 100th anniversary of the birth of our founder of the Institute and 10 years since we lost her. To sum up Rosalind Turek is very difficult, but what I hope is at the end of this event today, that those of us who knew her, who were very privileged, will feel closer to her and remember her very deeply. Those of us who didn't know her will feel that we knew her better and we understand her better. And as I was walking in New York yesterday with this incredible weather, I thought of icebergs, and I said to myself, the art of Rosalind Turek is really like an iceberg, because what we see, what we just heard, is only the tip of it. And if you go down all the strata, that's what nourished this unique and remarkable mind, this unique and remarkable musician. And I won't myself ever refer to Rosalind Turek as a pianist, even a keyboard artist, because she wasn't. She was much, much more. And those of us who knew her to be a writer, a scholar, a universal communicator, a visionary, a keyboard artist, and she herself never wanted to be pigeonholed. So it's very, very difficult in a very short event like we have today to summarize who she was and what she was. But we hope we put together a program which should, through various videos, various personal recollections, interviews, should give you an idea of who was this fascinating woman. We're going to begin, there are two parts, with video elements. Just to put it in the context, Rosalind Turek made her debut, not on a piano, but on a theremin. And that should tell us something, because who made her debut on a theremin way back when? Very few people. So that already makes a statement of who was this woman. She was not your usual person at all. Too big to describe. There's no words to describe her. But she also realized, way before most people did, how important audiovisual, how important video is. And hence, so much of what she did was filmed and is documented. And we want to share a few of those things with you today. We will start, there will be two videos. One video was filmed at her home, which was in Palm Ridge in 1972. And the second video was filmed in Rome in 1996. And she'll speak a bit there too. In my dealings with her, and I got to know her rather late, although I felt I knew her all my life, because I grew up as a boy listening to her recordings. And by circumstance and my work, I ended up producing one of her last recordings when I was working for Deutsche Grammophon. And I got to know her and became a very dear friend of her. And I learned tremendously from her, as so many of us have. And I hope that you will also learn, because our mission at the Institute is to perpetuate this legacy and perpetuate this great mind. And I think we all know great minds are hard to find all the time. But her mind, I think, comes once every century. And I think by watching and listening, we want to touch you, and we want you then to carry that legacy on. So we're going to start with this video retrospective, and we'll be back soon. Thank you.
Everyone knows, and virtually everyone who has ever played any keyboard instrument has studied. It took a genius of this universal mind and vision to be able to succeed in a work so simple as this. I would like to play a little of this on the harpsichord to just for the sake of the harpsichord sound in this work, and then I will play it on the clavichord. Now this is the sound of the C major prelude on the harpsichord. The clavichord actually is one of the most delicate, most sensitive of all instruments, outside of the nose flute, into which you breathe in order to make the sound. It's a great pity that the public doesn't know the clavichord more, and perhaps musicians as well, because it is so fragile an instrument and has such a delicate tone that it can't be heard in the way we make music in the 20th century style of concert halls, mm-hmm. which are much too large for the clavichord to be heard in. And this is beautiful on the clavichord. Of the quality, the nuances of feeling that come through a direct sense of structure and form is something that cannot be taught and which is different in every culture. Thank you.
As I said earlier, Rosalind Turek had an incredibly curious mind, and her mind went far beyond the confines of just being a keyboard artist or just even being a musician. And what I learned from her was that everything is connected. You can see parallels between biology and music, between law and music, between physics and music. So her mind encompassed so many disciplines, and she was always trying to find these parallels between these things. And obviously, in the music field, she never limited herself to just a keyboard instrument. And you saw that she, many, and I said she played the theremin earlier, but her interest went far beyond that. And that brought her into contact with many great personalities and many great musicians. And one of those, I'm very happy that we have here today, and those of you who were lucky to hear a wonderful concert yesterday, is the guitarist Sharon Eastman. And a guitarist, we said, well, how would that connect to Rosalind Turek? Well, with Rosalind Turek it would, because she saw beyond the confines of the instrument. And we'll have the opportunity to speak with Sharon in a moment. But first we're going to see an extract, a short excerpt from a documentary which has been recently produced about Sharon Eastman by the former WGBH PBS producer Susan Dangle in Boston. And in this excerpt we'll hear Sharon speaking about that time that she worked with Rosalind, and then we'll hear her in person.
While Sharon was an undergraduate at Yale, her passion for her craft grew. So did her ambition to broaden the repertoire. She wanted to find classical pieces that could be reconceived for the guitar.
She got very interested in Bach, who didn't write anything for the guitar because the guitar didn't exist yet in the form in which she plays it. And so she went to a leading figure in the Bach world to figure out how to do this.
Sharon got in touch with renowned pianist Rosalind Turek.
Her phone number was listed in the phone book. I literally called her up.
Rosalind Turek was a very great Bach player who figured out how to do things on the piano that nobody had figured out how to do before.
Although Turek was not a guitarist, she agreed to take Sharon as a student. That led to a 10-year collaboration, adapting suites Bach wrote for the lute to the guitar.
We have a real master from outside the world of the guitar in Rosalind Turek, giving her ears and her philosophies on Bach, and then combining that with what Sharon has been able to do on the instrument. We have these wonderful gems of transcriptions now that really expands beyond the typical way that a guitarist would think about that music.
We ended up spending an entire year on that suite. Every time I thought, okay, now we're ready to move on to something else, she would say, now we're ready to move on to the next level. I really learned what it meant to go deeper and deeper into something until you really feel you've begun to understand it and to express it.
Extraordinary honor. I feel very, very lucky that she happened to move back to New York at the time that I called her. And I can't even express what it meant to me in terms of changing my life. It was a very challenging time because I had no idea what I was in for. And I think that normal mortals think they have achieve things and they're on their way, but when they encounter a mind, as you say, that comes around every 100 years like us, I'm sure, it's another world. And the discipline that she demanded of herself, she would exact that from anybody else who crossed her path. And to spend 10 years working with her on the Boardman Suites was such an eye-opening experience in terms of coming to understand a little bit of her vast knowledge of structure, Baroque performance practice, embellishment, articulation, how to influence that in terms of color and dynamics, context, all kinds of things that really most other artists don't think of when they play Bach. It changed my life.
If you had to sum up Rosenberg in one word, an adjective, what would it be?
Well, it's impossible to sum it up in one word, but a passionate artist dedicated to bringing to light the music that she loves so deeply. That's not one word.
I tricked you, because Rosalind is impossible to sum up in one word. You couldn't sum up in a whole dictionary.
That's right.
None of adjectives to describe her. But going forward, in your teaching, because you're teaching at Juilliard as well, you obviously transmit what you learned from Rosalind to the next generation, and that's the way you're going to keep that living on. I want to talk a bit about this documentary, because this documentary will be seen in New York in April, is that correct?
It actually will be shown in this very auditorium on April 10th at 6 p.m. And I'm excited about it. There are a lot of wonderful guests who are involved, composers that have written for me, concerti, people like John Coriano, Christopher Rouse, and other composers, Joan Tower, and a slew of personalities from Martina Navratilova to Joan Baez, even David Hyde Pierce, the Grammys. It's an exciting thing for me to see the way they put this together, and I hope it will inspire other young people to really pursue their dream the way Rosalind inspired me. And I just have to share one anecdote that I think is something she told me once when she was conducting the London Philharmonia. And when she would bring a Bach score, she of course wanted to work with musicians to impart some of the ideas of embellishment and phrasing. And she started to focus particularly on the flutist. At one point, after coaching him on what embellishments to play, the concertmaster stood up and said, "I don't understand, you're spending all the time with this flutist, I'm jealous, you're not saying anything to me." And she realized this being her first conducting position with them, it could really go sour in a moment. So she thought, she said, "Well, if the truth be told, I prefer blondes." And everybody cracked up, and all harmony was restored instantaneously. So she had a wonderful sense of humor. And even though she was a taskmaster and very demanding of herself and of others, she really knew how to have a good laugh.
That's for sure. Thank you so much, and until next time. Thank you so much. Turek worked with many different artists, with composers, Aaron Copland, William Schumann. There are many, many composers and many great artists who are today performing. One of those we're very fortunate to have with us today, and that is an artist, a pianist, who started her collaboration with Rosalind Turek in 1983, and will be speaking afterwards, but she's going to play for us today the Chromatic Fantasy in Fugue. And that's Golda Weinberg Tass. So please welcome her. I can say is the legacy lives on. Thank you. Gonta, I would like to ask you a few questions. First, very obvious, how did you first come to meet Rosalind?
That was in the early 80s in Israel, during her master classes in Jerusalem Music Center. I was at that time a student of Manuel Krasovsky at the Rubin Academy in Tel Aviv, and he recommended, encouraged me to go listen to her master classes, not to play, I didn't dare at that time, but to listen and learn, because it was an experience for him during his Juilliard years here. He was numerous times listening to her master classes in Jerusalem and as well in performances.
That was 1983?
That was 1981. Yeah.
Then you came?
Then when she also was connected to my husband at the time, Shmuel Tatz, who introduced to her the body tuning system, and they worked very closely together. And when she found out that I was accepted to Juilliard School, she said, why don't you come and play for me while you're in New York? And not only Bach, she said. So that's how it began.
If I had to ask you, what marked her teaching? What was the most important element for you as a student of Rosalind Turek? What marked her teaching process?
The dedication not to give up, always to strive for higher and higher levels. So this is
I want the audience to know that not only has Golda studied with Rosalind Turek and carries on the legacy, but will carry it on to another generation through your competition. And I would like you to speak a little bit about the Rosalind Turek International Competition for Young Pianists, Bach Competition for Young Pianists, which you created and which you spoke to Rosalind Turek about shortly before her death.
Well, it was also before, when I would have lessons with her in 2002, we would have tea time after the 3 hours lessons, then there was the tea time. And then she would also ask me questions about students, my students, other students who compete in various competitions, and what are the requirements for competitions, what is the level of playing for Bach. And she was discouraged by several competitions that require either very little Bach or that playing is just not acceptable towards the performance practice. And she was the chairman of the competition, in World Piano Competition in Cincinnati. That was in 77, I believe. And over there, the competition is based on categories, not by age, but by categories. And that's how little by little I started to think about why not to have competition in Rosalind Turek's name, to continue her legacy. And basically the competition is about learning. That's what she wanted, to have performance, young performers from different countries, to learn about the performance practice that is required for this composer and the other.
And could you just tell us briefly, what year did you start the first competition here in New York?
Well, officially it was in 2005, but it did not happen because we did not have such good luck with advertising, and we started late. So we basically did not do the competition. It was a very low amount of applicants.
And then your first real competition was?
2008. And we had a wonderful selection from all over the world already, from Moscow. We had also competitors from Italy, from England, and the grand prize winner, Pobe Pan, is now named as National Arts Foundation, and she received some gold medals, so she's doing very well. And she was only 10 when she won, and then next to her were competing 19-year-olds. And
And the last competition took place?
Last competition took place in June 2013 for Rosalind's anniversary. And we are lucky to have here.
Oh, my word. We're very lucky to have, ladies and gentlemen, We had planned to have two laureates from the competition, two winners. Both coincidentally come from Los Angeles. One made the wise decision to arrive in New York 2 days ago and is here with us. The other unfortunately planned to travel yesterday. It is not here with us, but was so determined to show her appreciation that she made a video, which we'll show briefly, yesterday, put it together. And I would like to now welcome to the stage Athina Tsianos, who will perform for us the Bach English Suite No. 6, the Prelude, Saraband, and Jig. Am I right? Yes? And we'll talk a bit with her after. Thank you, Golda, and welcome, Athina. Thank you. What does Rosalind Turek mean to you?
Well, Rosalind Turek served as an extremely inspirational pianist, but not only a pianist, as you mentioned earlier, I mean, just her presence as a person is so inspiring. And through her research and studies into the music that she played, she made herself extremely unique and prominent in my life. And from her interesting interpretations, they've enlightened me, and even sometimes they've appeared innovative to me and made me rethink why I did a certain thing on in my music. So, and I have learned extremely a lot from her. So she serves as very much an inspiration.
And being a laureate of a competition named after Rosalind Turek, what do you feel winning this competition means to you? Has that encouraged you to take a different path?
Well, it has definitely encouraged me, and I wouldn't say a different path. Music is always something that I wanted to do the rest of my life. It just means so much to me, and what we can communicate through music. So especially winning this in Rosalind Turek's name, it means so much, and it's a fantastic opportunity to come to New York. And last June was my first time, so it meant a lot to me, not only accomplishing the prizes, but also the subsequent conversations I've had with members of the Turek Research Bach Institute and the jury. I'm very thankful for all of this. Thank you.
Last question. For you, what is special about Bach's music? Because you master it so well, so obviously you have an affinity. But what for you resonates about Bach's music?
Well, foremost, Bach is a composer that lived in a completely different era than ours presently. And not only that, but his music is so different compared to other composers like Haydn, Rachmaninoff, Prokofiev. So his music is interesting in that it challenges me to strive for stylistic elements that I wouldn't for in another composer. And more specifically, a balance between expression or improvisational quality and recalling the sound of instruments of Bach's time. And on a different note, as we can see through the dance movements of the suite, it represents a life and a lifestyle that is just so interesting. And also, as Rosalind Turek once lectured on the Schoenberg 12-tone system, Bach was the first composer to use this idea. So it's interesting looking at the degree of premeditated thought that went into each one of Bach's compositions.
Bravo. Thank you. I'm speechless. I think we see here another great mind coming, and this is very encouraging. As I said before, the other laureate, unfortunately, due to Arctic weather in New York, was stuck in beautiful Los Angeles and was so quick and so improvisational, she quickly made a very beautiful video to answer those questions and to play a bit for us. So we're going to have a look at that now. Her name is Alison Toe, so we welcome her.
I wish I could be here with you all today, but unfortunately, the snowstorm canceled my flight. I was really upset this morning when I found out that I wasn't able to go to New York. I even asked my mom to go to Boston, but she said that the airports are closed there too. I hope that I am also able to celebrate Miss Rosalind Turek's 100th birthday with you all, even though I am not there. So, hello everybody. First, I would like to thank Ms. Golda Tatz, Mr. Michael Cherry, and Mr. Kevin Kleinman for giving me this opportunity today. Supposedly, if I were there, Mr. Kleinman would ask me questions, but I will do it here.
When did you first encounter the music of Bach?
I first heard the music of Bach when I was 4 years old. My sister was practicing the Bach's Minuet in G, but I was too young to appreciate his music very deeply until I was much, much older, when I was about 10 years old.
What does Rosalind Turek mean to you?
I first heard about Rosalind Turek from Davide Cobasi, one of the competitors at Van Cliburn. She was one of his teachers in Italy. It is an honor to be associated with Rosalind Turek competition. My only wish is that I could have been born earlier so I could have gotten a chance to meet her in person.
What have you learned from listening to Rosalind Turek's recording of Bach?
It's very expressive and beautiful. It's more than just notes and pedal being played on the piano. The way Rosalind Turek plays Bach makes it very personal to me. But I'm sure that as each year passes on by, I will learn more and more things from her.
When you're playing the music of Bach, what is special for you about his music?
Bach's music is very complex and is basically the Bible of keyboard harmony. I'm still learning it, and it may take me a lifetime or even longer to understand what he was trying to express through the complicated notes he wrote. But hopefully, I'll get there in 10 or 20 years.
What has being a laureate of Rosalind Turek's International Bach Competition for Young Pianists meant for you?
It's a tremendous honor and a huge motivation. I hope that one day I will live up to Rosalind Turek's expectations and inspire other kids my age to love Bach's music more and keep an open mind about his music. Although I cannot be here with you at the Lincoln Center, I would like to share my aria Variata with you.
Thank you.
I think that's all the more incredible because they put that together just in a few hours, and that's remarkable. So talk about improvisatory minds, and that's really quite something. Now we come to the second part of the video tributes, and I have to tell you that this is very, very near and dear to my heart because I was the man behind the camera and the interview, and this was marked the beginning of my own personal association with Razvan Turek. As I said at the beginning of this event, I met her when we did the recording of the Goldberg Variations for Deutsche Grammophon, which she recorded at the age of 84. And this video was made in Oxford at her home, where she lived at the time, the following summer. So this was just in June 1998. And it was made in her house. And then I did an interview with her in her garden. And all I'll say is, look out for the little bird, and I'll tell you what that means afterwards. So please enjoy this.
This present recording of the Goldberg Variations does represent to me a kind of summation of my entire life's scholarly work. It is truly for me a sum of my whole life experience, musically, technically, in a scholarly way, as a performer, and as somebody who is interested in thought and feeling and ideas. I was attracted to Bach when I was 10 years old. I remember distinctly the moment when I felt a tremendous rapport with his music. I remember at that age mooning over some of the Bach pieces that I was studying. So from the age of 14, I began to play all Bach concerts. And at the age of 16, I was continuing, in fact, to finish all the 48 Preludes and Fugues. And I had an experience which some people might call superconscious moment, out of mind, whatever you like to call it. And I lost consciousness, literally. I think it was a period of 20 minutes. I don't know, it could have been 20 seconds. And when I came to, I was still sitting on the piano bench with the music in front of me, and I had a perception that I had not heard of before, as far as Bach's type and sense of structure and form is concerned. And at the same time, I knew that I had to create a new technique for playing Bach altogether, a new physical technique. Well, I must say that I felt I had gone through a small green door into a whole new universe. And this is the basis of my entire development in Bach. I learned the Goldberg Variations early in my 18th year. I learned them in 5 weeks and played them without the score at the end of 5 weeks at a school concert. And the following day, I met the president of Juilliard, and he said, "I'm so sorry I could not be at your recital yesterday because I understand that it's impossible to play on one keyboard." He said, "It's impossible." And I looked up at him and said, "Oh, I didn't know it was impossible." When I was about 33, I remember again the very moment when I said to myself, "I love all this other music, I love all kinds of music, but I find Bach the most challenging, the most difficult, but above all, the most interesting mentally, the most passionate, the most fulfilling emotionally, and the most fascinating even technically. And this is the richest world I could live in, and this is where I want to be." For me, the music comes first. And Bach's music rises far beyond the fashion of specific media. I believe that his music is essentially abstract. It is not tied to specific sonority. His music is timeless. Bach's imagination was very far-ranging, and Variation 29 is an example of his writing figurations that really predict possibilities far into the future. Nothing is more virtuosic than Variation 29, with chords, thick chords in trill fashion, and wild figurations going from the treble to the bass and back. love Bach because there is so much passion in his music. And although in some sense he's had a bad reputation in that he's supposed to be so intellectual, severe, and remote, the miracle of Bach is that he was capable of technical miracles, structural miracles, but at the same time, there was always profound feeling, charm, wit. And when we speak of wit, I want to call attention, for instance, to the 30th variation of the Goldberg Variations. That variation is a four-part piece, and it is built on two folk songs. One, the words to one of them is, I have not been with you for so long, and the other one is, cabbages and turnips have driven me away. That is a joke. And sometimes this last variation is played like a very serious, slow chorale, which is absolutely alien to its very nature. The real ending of the Goldberg Variations is the return to the aria. Now, the aria was the beginning of the work, and after traveling through all kinds of experiences through the Goldberg Variations, through 30 variations, we return to the aria. This moment, to me, is so sublime that even in speaking of it, I feel deeply emotional. This is a very profound concept. The end is the beginning, and the beginning is the end. It's a cyclic concept. It's very profound. It's a presentation of life and death, and death and life. And the end always gives rebirth. So I do not play this work as a tour de force, as an intellectual tour de force, as a dazzling display of technique, and it certainly does require an enormous technique of all kinds. I play it as a life experience. I have been asked if Bach were to appear on this planet, and you were to meet him, and you had only 30 seconds to say a few words to him, what would you say? And because what I've already projected in my attitude towards Bach, his passion and his miraculous brain, I would say to Johann Sebastian Bach, I love you.
Saw the bird, and when she saw that, because I showed that to her after we made that, and she said, that was Bach, because it was so strange, because the bird just appeared from nowhere, and I remember, because I was the one sitting on the bench asking her the question, and just at the moment I said, if Bach were to appear, there is this, and as soon as she answered and said, I love you, he chirped and went. Just at that second, and that's the end of that video. So it's very touching and very moving for me. We come sort of to the end, but we have a bit of I have a little surprise for you that's not on the program. Because at the Institute, we also devote a lot of our energies and thought to scholarship, to supporting young musicologists, young scholars, to carry on the tradition of Rosalind Turek in academia, and also to complete and expand on her writings. And we have, 2 years ago, gave a grant to a young Spanish, I should say Galician, from Galicia, musicologist, Juan Castinera, who's with us today, and I'm going to speak a little about his work here. So, Juan. First question, how you came to Rosalind Turek and what you actually did for your project that we sponsored for the Institute.
Well, I first came to Rosalind Turek indirectly because when I started playing the piano, you said I'm a musicologist, but I'm
also a pianist.
I was an admirer of Glenn Gould, and I heard when I was maybe 8 or 9, something like that, I was always listening to his Gold Variations, the two versions. And once I read a biography when I was studying English in Canada, of all places, and that he said that Rosalind was the only pianist who had an influence on his playing, the only one. And so, who is this lady, Rosalind Turek? In Spain, you have to imagine at the time, very few people knew about Rosalind Turek, and I didn't know about her either. And how funny that years after that, I was a subscriber of a magazine, classical music magazine in Spain, and this magazine reviewed the recording of the Goldberg Variations that was released in 1998, I believe, that you produced, and which I bought at the time. And so that was my first encounter. When I bought the recording, I was my first reaction, of course, was to compare it unconsciously with Glenn Gould, because I knew that Glenn Gould had such an admiration for her. And I found that it was extremely different, but also had things in common. So when years later I met you, through a different connection, through Alicia de la Rocha, who was my teacher at the time, another great pianist, I was fascinated and thought, well, there is something here beyond just coincidence. This just cannot be pure coincidence that so many things connected to Bach and Rosalind Turek are happening. And after that, yes, I had the pleasure, on the one hand, pleasure, on the other hand, it was a great challenge of editing Rosalind's writing on the Chromatic Fantasy and Fugue, which I did. I worked on that last year.
And I know you are very interested in her philosophy, in her way of seeing music and the way of seeing life. And if you could comment on that, because you've spoken very often to me about that.
Yes. Well, the great thing I learned about Rosalind goes far beyond piano playing or piano technique, and I think this is almost a leitmotif that has been present in this presentation today, how her thought and her view was not only a musical thing. The great lesson I learned is not to think in what I call watertight compartments, but to try and go deep and see the big picture, where everything is interconnected. What does this mean? It's kind of an abstract idea, but it is so important, particularly in today's world, where we approach things as specialists. And I myself, it's funny because when I was, I never defined myself as a pianist or a musicologist. And now I work in the philanthropic field in a foundation in Switzerland, Bach Foundation, or producing CDs. I always try to escape from one definition, trying to be one thing, because I always believe that as an intuition. And then Rosalind was also a model in that sense. Either if you are a businessman, or you are a musicologist, or you deal with whatever, with produce, it doesn't matter. Everything has an influence in everything else. And I think it's such an important idea today in a world where we are separating from each other, where we are, where we don't connect anymore, where we try to disperse everything. And that's not only a philosophical approach, it's just something that is urgently needed today. And I hope that this thought carries over.
It resonates so much with what Rosalind, what I spoke about earlier. I should mention, some people here may remember who knew Rosalind. Rosalind created a series called Interactions. It was actually a publication called Interactions. And the purpose of this was exactly that, to have different disciplines interacting, because she was a firm believer that everything is interconnected. And what did she do in those interaction events and publications? She brought, for example, a botanist. She would come up with an idea or a concept, and she'd ask the botanist to explain that from a botanist's point of view. And then she'd ask a chemist to explain that in his or her point of view. And then she'd bring it to music, and she'd explain in her point of view how you resolve a certain question, a certain problem, a certain issue. And hence it proves that all disciplines are interconnected. And I think that's one of her prevailing philosophies that she reinforced in myself. It was always there, but it crystallized when I had long discussions with her, that everything is connected. And we'd go on hours and hours talking about everything. And that's what made her so fascinating, that she was not limited to, let alone the piano, or let alone keyboard, let alone orchestra, let alone guitar. She was universal. And I think if anything we can leave today with, and I hope you do leave with the knowledge that this was a very exceptional person, and hopefully it will help you and encourage you to delve further into her background, her philosophy, and her thoughts. She wrote many publications. There's a lot of material you can find also on the internet. So I wish for all to perpetuate this brilliant mind to read about it.
I just wanted to say something in regards to this. When I had the pleasure of studying her material at Boston University at the Howard Gottlieb Archival Research Center, where her writings and were even a week is there from Rosalind is there, and her ashes and everything. When I studied there her material, I found writings by herself on topics such as rock music and the connection between rock and Bach, articles about fractal geometry of music. I think this one is actually posted on the website, if somebody of you is interested in mathematics and things like that. Such a variety, so this is really, when I'm saying interconnections, I mean it, because it's such depth, absolutely.
You talked about fractals. She was a very close friend of Benoit Mandelbrot, who died not too long ago, who was the father of fractal theory. And she held endless discussions with him, how you could explain Bach through fractal geometry, how fractal geometry could be interpreted into music. So again, all these interactions, these interconnections. And I think, as Schwann said so well, that is sadly missing, because we have become highly specialized in everything we do. And in being so specialized, we sometimes have a bit blinkers on, that we don't see all the various things that nourish and reinforce different ideas. And that's when I started by saying, walking in the Arctic, New York yesterday, thinking of icebergs, her theory is that, because what we hear is only the tip of the iceberg that's exposed. But everything which is far larger, that nourishes it, which we don't see, is enormous depth, enormous understanding, an enormous amount of awareness of every discipline, from geometry to science to astronomy, astrology. She was interested in everything. There was not a subject you couldn't speak to her about. And I recall even a dinner where she was talking about, she had read that the chicken, the DNA in chickens, is what was in some, could be traced back to dinosaurs. And this was a whole topic of a dinner discussion. And she went on and on and wanted to get books about chicken DNA and poultry's DNA to understand this better. So her mind was just endless. And with a person like that, if you were lucky enough to have her as a friend, as a teacher, it expanded your own horizons and your own mind. I think we have to get back to that. So she should be, for us all, a model to try to get a bit back to. We have access to all that information, more now than when she did. We had our touch of a button, we can get all that information. I want to thank everyone who participated, everyone who played, and to you, the public. We have now, you're all cordially invited, we have a reception in the foyer, And of course, we can talk there and you can ask your questions there. I want to say thank you again to everyone and thank you to Rosalind.
The whole presentation, it really opened, you know, my eyes with, in terms of being well-rounded, not just, you know, as a musician, but with other subjects. I actually study with one of Turek's pupils, Miss Golda Tatz, and, you know, she always spoke very highly about her and her knowledge in terms of Bach's music. And I think it's a very good piece of advice for anyone that's studying music seriously to interconnect many different things.
Well, the most interesting thing about today's program is that it's clear that her legacy continues, and there are a new crop of great performers that bring a different sensibility to Bach. Her ideas, her research into Bach and performance practices continue on and to continue to live on after her wonderful life that she shared with the whole world as a great performer.
I only know about her as a keyboard artist, and I was duly reproached for not knowing what a wonderful person she was. I think the expansiveness of her knowledge, the fact that she was interested in so many fields, and seeing the videos of her where she seemed so warm and wonderful and funny. So she's a new hero, right? So I want to know more about her.
I think I learned more deeply how her innovation and the depth of her knowledge, not just about Bach and music, but in all of the different areas that were mentioned, how deeply that resonated with people who are interested in her life and career and her performance, and how she didn't just collect knowledge, she found a way to apply all of the things that she studied to her work. It's extraordinary to hear people talk about the innovation that she brought to the performance of Bach, and you can see when people speak about her how passionate they are about having had the chance to study with her, meet with her, and to learn from her. Again, not just about music, but in this very kind of broad, very humane, very extraordinary sense that she brought to her life.
I think one can't be interested in Bach without appreciating her renditions of Bach. But I think she's just an icon, and her knowledge of science as well as music I think is very important for understanding the full breadth of what living experience and knowledge is about.